Everybody, today I am playing with this fun little pumpkin that I drew here, and a few of you loved the perception of the last pumpkin piece I did. Let me grab it. Which, one second here, I thought was kind of fun because it was looking kind of top down, almost looked like a table type runner. So that was really fun. But today I wanted to paint one more face on. So I'm gonna do that. But before I start, I wanted to play with a little color palette here. And I got an interesting thought from one of you that, gosh, I can't remember where they lived, but they said they have blue and white pumpkins, which I thought was really fun. So I'm going to try and paint a more white pumpkin. I think I have seen them. Like, we've got this one here, which is kind of fun. And it's got some green and red. So that's a little bit. I had to go searching for that and found it at Trader Joe's. So I'm going to do that type of coloring. I've got my Artisto pad here, which I'm actually, I think, going to use in landscape mode. As you know, I love these. They're ring bound. I talk about them all the time because I think they're just the perfect little student grade. I love Arches paper, but I can't afford to paint on them daily for all the paintings I do. And I've tried Canson and all the others. This one I love the most. This is that Artisto brand, 140 pound, cold press. And let's see, I'm going to be using my 8 Velvet Touch Princeton brush. Actually, I'm just going to be doing a color swatch on here. I'm going to use the Artisto, the larger pad of paper. This is 9x12 to actually paint on. Let's see, one second. Let me show you something here. So this is the Artisto, the larger pad. It's also 30 sheets, 9x12, 140 pound. And I will list that, the link, if you do want the larger sheets. And then the little mini ones, I do my sketches, my smaller drawings, all my little notes, I refer back to them. So much fun stuff. Okay, I've got my Meeden ceramic two wells, which I absolutely love. Talk about those all the time. You've got your wash, your rinse, really important with watercolors. And this little dish is really nice. It's ceramic, a little bit heavier. It won't tip over, which is a nightmare. And I've had happen. I'm also using my MeiLang paints. I love Winsor Newton, but again, can't afford to paint with them every day. And this is a great little palette, especially for the beginner, or if you're a lazy mixer like me that sometimes just wants to paint and doesn't want to take time to mix some of the colors. I am going to mix a few here, but for the most part, I'm going to use what's in my palette. If you're a beginner and you want a little bit more affordable brush because you're not sure and don't want to make the investment in the Princeton 8 Velvet Touch, I think this one is about $12 to $14, size 8 round. You can get this whole set, which I've been using these Degatos, the round set. It's about $12 for about 6 months now. Really happy. They're really springy. The tips are staying nice and sharp. So I love these. This is their, let's see, they're 7, 8. Where's their 8? This is their 8, which is a little bit bigger than the Princeton, but love these brushes. So for the beginner, these are great. And I'm going to be mixing here some greens and oranges on my palette. This is always also made by Meeden, and I love it because it's small and it has these really large areas for mixing my paint, which I love. Okay, let's get started. So I think on, for this little white pumpkin, I'm going to use an olive green for some of the greens, and then an orange, and that's basically what I'm going to use. So let's go ahead and mix our paints. I'm going to pick up a little bit, so I just tapped my, let me move some stuff here. Dipped my brush in the water here, and then actually the clean water, the rinse water, is the one you want to do. Tap off my brush, and going to pick up some of the MeiLang, although in Winsor Newton it's the same. It's their olive green, because that's kind of my go-to green. And notice I'm not going in with the tip and smashing and mashing my tip. I'm going in with the side of the brush, but still making sure it isn't, I'm not loading my brush all the way back to the ferrule here. Okay, so there we go. I'm going to add some more water there and get it that nice consistency. That's real flowy. If I tilt my palette, it moves pretty easily. And I'm going to also start with a lighter value, just meaning more water. So let's put this here. As you know, I love making these color boards. So for this particular painting, I'm going to use, let's go ahead and get a darker shade of that olive green. I'm going to mix my olive green. I'll probably use it by itself too. So wash and rinse my brush. 4, 5, 6. And you know you have all the paint off your brush if you go on a paper towel and it's clear. Okay, you know you need to rinse it a little bit more if you're leaving behind a color. So I think I want to mix this with, let's try some of that MeiLang. This is why I'm enjoying this palette so much, gold. So I'm making this so that I can reference, if I come up with a color I really like here, they call this royal gold, by the way. If I like this color, I can come back to it and make it again because I've got my little reference color board here. So this plus this, and I'm gonna add some green, is going to make this color. So that's really pretty. I don't know if you can see how pretty that is. It's a shimmery green. It's a little bit lighter because I'm essentially adding this gold paint, which is like a yellow. So I'm going to make a note there what I mix. So this was olive green plus royal gold, and this is what I got. So I'll use that color, and then let's pick up our cad orange and see what we can get with that. Now I want that to be a little bit more muted, smoky-ish. So I have two choices here. I can add some green to it, which, let me grab my color wheel. Whenever you add opposites on the color wheel, it's going to give you like a shadowy, deeper, musky shade, a little bit grayer shade, browner shade. So orange and blue are opposites on the color wheel. So let's just mix that together and play with that. I'm gonna grab my blue here. Let's see, which blue do I want? I think I wanna use just regular blue. Yeah. So let's add orange and blue together and see what we get. See if that's the color I'm kind of looking for. And this could be, I think in MeiLang, it's referred to as, let's see, which one is it? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Ultramarine, which is the same in your Winsor Newton. So that's kind of handy. Whoops. Now let's add some orange to that and see if I get kind of that brown color that I'm looking for. Yeah, it's actually almost turning an olive green. See that? Interesting, right? So it's really fun to mix opposites sometime and get those colors. Now the other thing I will do is I want a lighter version of that. So let's just pull that out a bit. By adding water, we get a lighter value. And look at that. That's almost exactly the colors that I want. I'll do the same with the orange. Whenever I paint, I try to create the different values of my color so I can make sure I'm including them in. So I'm just going to pull some of that out like that. There we go. And there's my three values of that. Here's kind of my three values here. Let me list this. This is Cad Orange plus Ultramarine Blue equals this olive green, actually. But what I did here is I also mix that royal gold to kind of get a pretty coloring of that. So there you go. I think I've kind of got my colors. What I'll probably do too is use, they call this in MeiLang, the Van Dyke Brown, which to me looks like kind of a burnt sienna in Winsor Newton. And then just pull that out to see the different values. I'll probably use something like that for the stem. And there we go. There's our Van Dyke. What do they call it? Van Dyke Brown. So those will be basically my colors I use for my pumpkin today. Okay, let's get started here. We're going to be using the technique wet on dry. And I might go a little bit wet and wet. What I want to do first off is just have my color palette ready. So I've got my green here, my olive green, and that just happens to be my go-to green. You may have a different green that you like. And I'm going to put some of that royal gold right here next to it so that I can mix it as I feel for some of that other version of that green. And let me get some orange in my palette. There we go. I know I have a little bit of another orangey color in there, but that's okay. We're just gonna kind of put them together. And there we go. Okay. And as you see, all these paints, look at how free they move. That's the consistency I want. Okay, that's the consistency I like to paint with. So I've got these lines drawn here already, and I'm going to make a little kit out of this for you. So if you want to paint this, grab it. It's $5 on Etsy. I do get about $3 from it. I save that up to buy more supplies. You'll get this drawing, you'll get my colors that I mixed. I'll put these in there so you, if you liked my colors, you can kind of mix them yourself. Color mixing can be fun, but a lot of times I just want to paint and I don't want to deal with that. I'm trying to get, there's a little bit of orange in my brush. Okay. Okay, so let's get started. I'm going to do two versions here. I'm going to wet some areas first and then go in. And then I'm also going to do, so you can see the difference. So first I'm going to work wet on dry, which just means I'm picking up my pigment and I'm going to make sure I don't have too much water on my brush. So if you need to, you can dab it off and get some of that off. And then I'm going to go in holding my brush near the bottom of this metal tip where it joins the handle at more of a horizontal. Use the tip of my brush. I want to pick up a little bit more water. I felt like my brush was kind of dry there. And I can kind of tell how much water I have in my brush because the more water, and this is something you'll get used to, the fatter my brush will be. So that's how I can tell a lot of times how much water as well. It's obviously got too much water if it's dripping, but that's another way I tell. So point, I'm going to put more pressure and just come down here like that. Now I want to rinse my brush and go alongside that because that's just me. I like a softer line. I'm going to go pick up a little bit more of that paint. And I'm going to just go in. Now I'm working wet and wet. So I'm going into that wet area and look at how beautiful that is. Okay, let's go into the bottom here. Let me pick up some water And we're going to move upwards, point, press, just like that. I'm kind of using the side of my brush. And then clean my brush, 5-6. And I can go in and just feather that out a little. Just like that. Okay, look how beautiful that is. So that is wet and dry, but then I'm going in with a wet, damp brush, clean. And I kind of soften all those edges, okay? Now let's try, I think I wanna add a tiny bit of that green in too while it's wet. So let me show you that technique. Since it's wet on wet, I don't want too much water on my brush. So look at that. If I tap on here, it gets rid of a lot of that. And now I can go in and just kind of draw some lines and let it spread itself. Like that. Isn't that pretty? And it's gonna kind of create this shadowy effect. So there you go. Let's move on to our next little segment. And I think what I'll do with this one is let me show you, I'm gonna wet it first with a damp brush. Now I don't wanna wet it so much that I've got a pool of water. I'm just making it shine. That's it. I just want it damp. Like that, okay? So if I hold it up to the camera, there's no puddles you see, it's just damp. Now with wet on wet, you have to work a little quick. So let me pick up some of that orange. If you think you have too much water, just tap it off and go in here and lay down some of that paint. Just like that. Isn't that pretty? Kind of went out of the lines there. I don't freak out about it. Just can kind of pick that up. So it's a little, oh, and see, I just stuck my hand in that. A reason why, really, for the most part, I'm right-handed, so I try to work left to right. But that time I went right to left. Okay, while this is still kind of wet, I want to go in and drop in just a little bit of that green, which I actually took straight out of my palette, but as you saw, you can blend it here with orange and blue if you chose to. And that's always kind of fun. There we go. And adding in a little bit more of that green. Maybe some orange. You don't want to mix this green and orange too much on your paper. Like it's more dropping it in and letting it mix itself, because otherwise it's going to kind of blend and turn into like mud. So I'm hoping I'm keeping a lot of this whitish, creamish color of the pumpkin in there. Let's go in the bottom of this pumpkin. So see the differences here? I wet this first and went in on this one. I waited a little bit longer, and that's why I have some of these blooms. So what happened is the water I went in with, the pigment I went in with, was wetter than the area I was painting onto. So it creates blooms. So let's go in here. And because my paper's drying kind of quickly, I've got a fan going here. I've got to work quickly and get in there with my paint. So I'm going to go in with this green right now. Like that. And I'm trying for the most part to leave a lot of that white space. So there you go. I might even play with maybe that gold and creating a very light value of that so that this isn't pure white. I could maybe do that because I'm kind of finding that's too much white space. So I might go in with a little bit of that gold just to give it a feeling that it's not pure white, which I kind of don't like. Just going in with a damp brush and smoothing that out. So I think I like that a little bit better. What I might even do is let's play with this, and then you can choose which way you want to paint. But let's try creating, let's put a glaze, let's do, well, we'll do this one, a glaze of that very light gold, the royal gold I picked up in the MeiLang palette. If you don't have that metallic, just use like a yellow ochre. And let's just do a very light wash over this pumpkin and see how this works. So you're going to have a few different options here, and you can choose which one you kind of want to use. So I've painted over this with a very light value glaze, okay? And now what I'm going to do is go in with maybe some of that green like that. And see what we think about that. Now, you're gonna may see some blooms here because I went in with wet paint on paint that isn't as wet. So this is probably gonna bloom here. I'm gonna just darken that a bit, because I want it to look darker where it's getting up near the top and going to start folding in like that. Just taking a damp brush, just kind of moving that a bit. So there you go. Don't want to go into this too much until this dries. And I know this is dry when it's not cool to the touch. I'm going to go down here near the bottom because I feel like I want this to be a little bit more shadowed, and just paint a line. This is dry now, of that darker paint, and then rinse my brush real good, turn my paper, and I just want my brush to be barely damp, and I'm going to go in and just push and pull, feather that out. Which, if you've watched my tutorials, you see I use this technique an awful lot. And there you go. You've got a little bit of that shadow in there. We can do that here too. Matter of fact, I'll even mix some of my green and orange. And let's just create a little bit of that shadow here. Wash, rinse my brush, pat it off so it's just barely damp, and feather that in. There we go. Like that. Can go in and add a tiny bit more green at the bottom. And it gives that feeling of a shadow down there. So this, let's go into this now. It's dry, I can tell, because it's not cold anymore or cool to the touch. And let's just go in and add a little bit of green in here. So I'm painting right now, wet on dry. Like that. And then I'm going to soften that line. So I rinsed and washed my brush. Got to make sure I don't put my hand in there. And I'm going to go just along the edges of that and kind of feather them. I'm trying to keep my wrist out of the front of the camera So I'm just kind of pulling out and softening those edges. So there you go. So this pumpkin is really getting some dimension to it. I'm gonna go in and darken. Keep in mind, watercolors dry darker than when you first put them on. So that's why a lot of this is lightening up, okay? And also why I use glazing, because glazing, you just keep darkening the colors. So I kind of liked that. Let's go in and maybe add a light value of the orange, which just means more water versus paint. And I'm gonna go in and maybe add a couple little fun things like that. Maybe down here, just using the side of my brush. Something like that. Okay, let's do this last little section we got going on here. And I think I'm gonna go in with that watered down version of the gold metallic, or you can use your yellow ochre. Sorry for all these little mishaps down here. And go in and just give that a glaze or a wash of that pretty green metallic. There we go. And then I'll go in with that with maybe some green. Now, right now, because I'm going wet and wet, it's spreading rather nicely. There we go. Wash and rinse my brush and maybe just help it a little bit. Just pull it along. There we go. Just like that. And that's why it's so important to keep the tips of our brush in great condition, because you're going to do things like that where you want to be able to rely on the tip of your brush to get that fine line. There you go. So I quite like this. Now let's move on to our stem. And I'm gonna have to be careful because this is still kind of wet up in here. So when I'm doing my little stump there, let's see, what color should we use? Let's see what color this is. They're referring to this as burnt brown, so it's probably like burnt umber. There we go. And I'm gonna do kind of a glaze on this. Like that. I'm even pulling a little bit into that green, but I'm leaving an awful lot of white space up there, okay? Up in here. Now I can go ahead and, sorry, I think my camera is shaking there. Maybe add a little green, leaving some white space. And let's go in with a darker, deep brown. So they refer to it as Van Dyke brown. And we'll just create some little lines and things. Once it dries a little, we can go back in there and expand on that. So let me wash and dry my brush, make sure it's clean. And I'm just noticing I have this little tiny sliver of a pumpkin in the background. So I'm gonna use that gold again. Make sure I don't touch my stem, otherwise it's gonna bleed in. Okay, now I feel like I have too much water on my brush. So see there, I can go in and pick up a little bit of that. Now, this is going to be shadowed back here. So for a shadow, we mixed our orange and blue, or you can use your olive green. I kind of liked the way that orange and green mixed up. I thought that was a really beautiful color, and it had the undertones of the orange, which I think is quite nice. So I'm just going to go in with that in the background and touch in. There we go. So it kind of pulls it in the background. Now we could go in here and add some darker values because this somewhat looks like the same value to me. And that's how you can create interest. So I went in with a darker, that darker green, and I'm just gonna create, not too much, because after all, my intention was to create this whitish colored pumpkin, which as you see, I've already added a lot and it doesn't look so white anymore. That's okay. Go into the back here. Again, why it's so important to have a good tip on your brush. So I'm going into my, either using olive green or you can add a little bit of your blue to that olive green, which I think really makes a pretty color. And I'm just creating a few lines, make sure I'm not putting my hand in there again. Light pressure, okay? Because we just want to use the tip of our brush. So light pressure and your brush mostly up and down. Because the more you hold it to the side, you're going to use more of the side of your brush. So there you go. Just adding in a few details. Now, I really don't like lines like that, so I'm gonna wash and rinse my brush and go up to them with just a tiny bit of water on my brush, just damp really, and I just soften those edges because I'm just not a fan of hard lines. It's one of the reasons why I've enjoyed watercolors so much, is because of that soft quality that it can have. And I think I'm pretty happy with this. I might add a little bit of this beautiful olive green that I created from brown and blue into my stem here. Let's see what that looks like. Yeah, I like that. And there you go. I think I'm about done. So I gave you a few different ways of painting these, and you can kind of decide, you know, which you liked. You can go wet into wet. You can go wet into dry and use a damp brush to feather the edges. You know, figure out kind of what your style is and what you enjoy and work with that, because that's what's going to work best for you. Now I'm just continuing to play here. And I will put this drawing, you could even add leaves over here. I did a leaf tutorial yesterday. You could add a few of those over here. I will put this in my Etsy kits. They're $5. And I'm also going to give you the little swatch sheet. We really didn't use a lot of gold in here, but you could certainly mix gold with any of these colors to give it a little bit more shimmer. And I'll list all my supplies and just have fun with this. Kind of discover your own style, what you gravitate towards. I gave you three different options of painting these. See which one comes most natural for you and have fun with that. All right, everybody, thanks so much for being here. This was so fun. And thank you to that wonderful viewer that said, hey, we only have white pumpkins and blue pumpkins. That really kind of inspired me. I thought that was kind of fun. So I'd only seen blue pumpkins at TJ Maxx, so I didn't know they were a real thing. All right, everybody, thanks so much. Have fun, and I will see you all soon.